Hi guys, my name is Kirsty and welcome to Upside Down Books. Today I'm going to be doing a review and discussion of The Red Ribbon by Lucy Adlington. I was very kindly sent a copy of this for review from Alan Unwin, so thank you very much for that, and now I shall be reviewing it. This book was incredible. I'm just gonna start off the bat by saying it was a 5 out of 5 star read. I loved it. So the question is, what is it about? So The Red Ribbon is actually an historical fiction book set during World War II, specifically inside of Auschwitz. We follow a main girl called Ella. I peg her at being around 12 years old, although she constantly lies saying that she is 16 in order to get work within the concentration camp. Now, coming from such a naive perspective, the book is immediately unique and fantastic. But the book follows her story as she kind of survives through a year within this concentration camp, and we learn a little bit about her past, and watch her as she grows as a person, I suppose, and makes a few friends along the way. This book is just absolutely wonderful. Now, this will be a spoiler-free review, as always, on here, but I will be writing and possibly have already got it up on my blog, a full review, and within that I will have a nice spoilery discussion for you guys. So if you do want to find out more of the nitty-gritty details, or if you've read it yourself and you want to know what I had to think about those parts, hop along there and you can go and check that out. I always have such a weak spot when it comes to historical fiction. Being an absolute admirer of history, and particularly of this era, I was so excited to pick up this book. Why was I excited? Well, for starters, when I first received it, I thought, oh, that's a pretty cover. And then when you read the blurb, it starts talking about these four girls and how they might have been friends in another life, but they're at a place called Birchwood, which is their term for Auschwitz within the camp, and they are seamstresses, they make dresses. So these girls are sewing for their lives. It kind of gives you that impression that if they were to mess up anything, that's it, they would die. And that pretty much is the case. But what I didn't realize is that it was set in a concentration camp, because it's not until a couple of chapters in that Adlington name drops Auschwitz in there and you go, oh my god, this is not a fantasy medieval story, this is real, this is really happening over here. So I really enjoyed the way that it was written from that perspective, that everything is not explicitly told to you, so it's a very different sort of narrator's perspective to what you might usually get in your books. I would very much so compare this to The Boy in the Striped Pyjamas, and I'm pretty sure like it's officially being compared to that as well, but it reads in that sort of naive perspective. So The Boy in the Striped Pyjamas doesn't understand what the concentration camps are, and he doesn't understand why there is a boy in striped pyjamas. Slightly similar but slightly different, seeing as Ella is actually inside the camp. You very much so get the perspective that she's just sort of ended up in this concentration camp, doesn't understand that A, it is a concentration camp, B, what she's done wrong, or C, when she'll get to go home again. She, in a very childlike way, just knows that there are certain things she has to do to make sure that she can stay alive. For a long time in the book, there is reference to the chimney smoking and people not coming back, so it's like as though Ella has some awareness of what's going on. She's aware that people are dying, she's aware that people are not returning, and she's aware of how strict consequences are if she doesn't come back. But she is refusing to believe it. She's kind of blindsiding herself and saying, I'm not gonna pay attention to that, I'm just gonna sew my dresses. It's an absolute darling of a book because Ella is so passionate about sewing. And that was such a cool part of the story. It's weird because the whole book reads very much so as this beautiful dedication to everyone who lost their lives in World War II, particularly in the camps. And it's obviously written by someone who knows what they're doing, and if you do a bit of research on Lucy Adlington herself, I think she was an historical costumer? I think that was the term. She knows her stuff is the point, she's done a bit of historical research, as you would hope if you're writing historical fiction. But Ella is so dedicated to her sewing. We slowly get this background story about her at home and how she helped out her grandmother. So in those scenes where she's actually sewing dresses, she's putting so much passion into it, and it makes the story feel very much so as if the focus is really on Ella as a person and how she keeps the integrity of her good-naturedness despite everything that's happening around her. It's super interesting. Then there's also the layer of the story where the tagline comes in, and the four main characters that we're dealing with are Ella being our narrator. We have Rose, who is a friend that she makes in the camp. Carla, who is one of the Nazi guards, and Marta, who is like the boss at the seamstress place within the camp. The idea of that story there is that they might have been friends if they weren't all in the camp, and I thought that was a really interesting way to sort of play with the relationships and explore how different things are when you have such a severe power structure put in place, and social prejudices that just prevent people who really could have otherwise got along getting along. That was really interesting, and I thought that was well done within the book. In fact, there's nothing in this book that I think has been done poorly. Everything is fantastic. I was sad that it was only just under the 300 page mark, and I am so excited to read more of Adlington's works. This book is just incredible. For anyone who's not so savvy with historical fiction out there, let me just maybe explain a few things. You're probably thinking, seamstress, Auschwitz, 12-year-old girls? I don't understand what's going on. So taking a step back, obviously I'm hoping we all know that there was the Holocaust during World War II. In the Holocaust, Hitler had constructed some concentration camps, labor camps, whatever name they were used, and Jews, disabled people, other minorities that the Nazis deemed as subhuman were sent to these camps to work or to die, basically. As soon as they get off the train, they are divided into basically two groups, people that are immediately sent to the shower rooms where they are poisoned and burnt and killed, and then we have the other people who are sent to work until they drop, basically. And the more historical fiction I'm reading, the more I am actually learning about these concentration camps. Being someone who has a history degree, and being the fact that I did modern history, and being the fact again that you would have thought in modern history I would have combed through the wars with a fine-tooth comb, I am constantly surprised by authors like Adlington presenting to me elements of common knowledge history that I've not come across before. Now, this wasn't as shocking as a book that I've previously read called The Butterfly and the Violin. That one is by Christy Cambron. If you like this one when you read it, highly recommend reading that one. If you've read that one, make sure you pick up a copy of this one. In The Butterfly and the Violin, it follows a violinist who gets sent to Auschwitz-Birkenau. And in there she works, well not works, but she becomes part of a band. There are so many different elements within these concentration camps that these people were sent to that they did within them. So it's much more than just the bog standard that you get in a history textbook, that they were there and they kind of dug their own graves and then they died. Like, there are so many different things happening. In The Butterfly and the Violin, the band performs throughout the camp, they perform for Nazi officials at different events, and then there are other things like the seamstress tailoring factory that was in the camp itself. So there are lots and lots of things happening, and I really feel like I need to go and get myself a non-fiction book and sit down and actually do some research, because I think I'm just going to keep uncovering more. This is based on a real thing. There was something called the Upper Tailoring Studio, I think is the name given to it, where women were recruited in if they had, you know, good needlework and could sew really well, and it was established by the commandant's wife of that particular area. Initially the commandant's wife had the inmates, if you will, to come to the private house and to make clothes for her, because it's free labour and good labour for the most part, unless they deliberately try to jeopardise their work. She then further exploited this opportunity by starting up this tailoring studio and making it a service available to more of the guards out there. I just love it. I just love when I come across a book like this and it really explores one of these sort of minor elements. It's not just your standard story that's retelling you the story that you already know with different characters. It's educating you and it's telling you more about this period, and that is the best thing about it. One of the really clever things that Adlington has done in this book as well is the avoidance of using specific names. Nazi is never used, Jew is never used, and other terms like that. She has a reason for doing this, and it's not so much to ignore the groups that have happened or to not acknowledge them. What Adlington has tried to do, let me just read you this little excerpt from her author's note at the back, by avoiding these names is very, very clever, and I really like it. So she says, "In the Red Ribbon, my heartfelt aim has been to revisit a time in our past that clearly and categorically happened, but also lift the stories out of historical specifics in order to show universal experiences." She then goes on to talk about hate crimes and how they're never good enough. So what she's saying is by taking away labels, it becomes much more relatable, because you're not reading it going, "Oh, well, I'm not a Jew, I can't relate," or, "Oh, I'm not a disabled person, I can't relate." You're going, "Hey, this is a 12-year-old girl," and obviously for any women reading it, you go, "I was 12 once, and that could have been me." It's so much more relatable as soon as you take away the labels. And it also helps to pull Carla's story a bit better in, because you're not going, "Nazi, Nazi, Nazi." She's always referred to as the guard. And guard is a fairly inoffensive term for the most part. So this is definitely a 5 out of 5 star rating for me. Please go along and have a look at my review on my blog, which is ozbooksnail.com, if you want to read some more information about it. It has such a beautiful friendship in it. It has one of the best endings to a book that I have read in a long time. Absolutely beautiful and heartwarming. And it has such a rich cast of characters. So make sure you go grab your copy. The book came out in September, and I believe the paperback is coming out really soon all over the world. So enjoy, and I will see you in my next video. Goodbye.